Release 12.2.2 installation overview. For those of you who are new to release 12.2.2 installation, this overview will be very handy for you to go about installing it from scratch. So let's understand how do we go about installing it. Basically, the entire installation is divided into two parts. It happened in two phases. The first thing that you've got to do it is you've got to start by installing release 12.2.0. Fine. So as a part of that installation, you've got to do a number of pre-installation steps, which I will explain you in a little while. Then once you have completed those pre-installation steps, then you go and actually do and run the standard installation using Rapid Install Wizard. Once you have done that, then you complete the installation by applying a number of database and application tier patches. Once that's done, you go and verify the installation from front end, whether everything is okay or not, or whether you're getting any errors. If at all you're getting any errors, then you must fix those errors before you go on to the second phase of upgrading from release 12.2.0 to release 12.2.2. So let's assume that you have successfully completed release 12.2.2 installation until this step. Then you go and do the upgrade as a second phase, wherein you apply a number of patches. One of the mega patch is applying the ADN TXK release update pack. And then once you have applied that, then you actually apply the release 12.2.2 suite-wise release update pack. And once that's done, you complete the installation by performing a couple of post-upgrade steps, and then you go in the front end to verify whether you have successfully installed release 12.2.2. So at this stage, I want to show you each of these steps in terms of their overview, and there are a lot of things that goes into it, and what you see over here is a very hunky-dory picture, but actually there are a number of things that goes into it. But before I go into this, I would like to show you the evidence that we have actually indeed successfully installed release 12.2.2, so that there is no scope of any speculation in terms of what we are telling you. So I will minimize this, and then I will go into Oracle applications. So here is Oracle applications that we have installed, and I will log in as the default demonstration user and password welcome, and hit the login button. And here I will simply go to any responsibility, say application developer, then I go to a form. All I want to open is basically Oracle application forms, so that I can show you that indeed we have installed Oracle 12.2.2. So from here, I will simply go to help and go to about Oracle applications, and you would see that this instance is presently on release 12.2.2. So basically, I would like to show that as an evidence that we have indeed done it. So the steps that I'm showing you have indeed all worked, and they are a gist of what we have done. Okay, so what I'm going to do at this point of time, I will close this and we'll go back to the presentation. So here, as a next step, you have to do the first phase, as I explained you, you have to start with release 12.2.0 installation. Now, all the steps that I'm showing you holds good for both Vision Demonstration Database as well as Production Database. But these instance which I've just shown you was out of Vision Demo instance. And then we will follow these steps for any of those two instances. So the first thing that you've got to do is these pre-installation steps for installing release 12.2.0. So you need to have some specific system requirements. More about system requirements, I'm going to explain you a little while, but at a very high level, I would say that you must have at least 10 gig of RAM so that this server runs smoothly. Smoothly means for personal use, if you install Vision Demonstration Environment. But if it is less than that, then it's going to kind of stall your entire laptop or desktop, wherever you are installing it. So my recommendation would be perhaps, you know, take a desktop and then install it, which will have around 10 gig to 16 gig of memory. And then the system is not shaky and it runs smoothly. In fact, while installing it itself, it would be faster enough and it won't be that slow. Okay, now more about the exact RAM, the sizing requirements, etc. I would be covering it a little later, so let's hold on for some time. Then once you have that kind of a system in place, then you've got to go by installing the operating system. Now for demonstration and for this course purposes, we have installed the complete system in Oracle VirtualBox on Oracle Linux x86-64, which is on version 5.7. So you've got to have that done. And again, it's not a straightforward installation. While installing the Linux itself, you have to basically install a number of libraries and you have to configure the Linux parameters, the Linux kernel parameters. And then for specifically for release 12.2 installation, you have to also install a whole lot of libraries that goes in, without which EBS installation would fail. Then the next step is you have to go about installing the public yum utility, which will help you to get latest file right from the public Oracle Linux, and there you can download it and install the latest software. In fact, this has helped me considerably in getting the latest files, and all I found is just around 3 libraries which were actually missing after running a yum update. All that again I'm going to show you a little while later, what all the libraries I could not install via yum and I have to download basically manually and then install it manually. Okay, anyway, I will show you how to go about configuring the yum and how to go about updating your libraries. Then we will go about completing the pre-installation dependencies and requirement of libraries. Basically, we'll run through the list what all is required as a part of installation, and then what are all the dependencies which are there in terms of dependencies within the libraries. Then we'll go ahead and configure a number of kernel parameters and installing the libraries that we have identified in the Linux environment. Then we will understand what all the software that we need to have in terms of installing release 12.2.0 and then release 12.2.2. As I've just explained you previously, this is a two-step process. So when you go to download the software from Oracle website, don't be get tempted to download all the software. You have to download only specific software, and it's a bit confusing to clearly demarcate what goes into release 12.2.0 and release 12.2.2. So I'm going to explain you very clearly what goes in there, and you can basically take my notes as a reference to download the software. It basically helps a lot, because if you unzip unnecessary software in the staging area, then it basically affects your installation. Sometimes your installation doesn't complete at all. So I have gone through all that, and that's where the gist of all that you will find it in this chapter. Then we will actually go and download the software. In fact, I have downloaded the software already. So I'm going to simply take you through the website and I will tell you where exactly you will go and download the software. Once we have downloaded the software, then we've got to set up the staging area. Now, setting up the staging area is not very straightforward. Like until release 12.1.3, you got to do what? You got to simply download the software from Oracle eDelivery website, unzip it, and then simply start the installation process. But now you cannot do that. Out of the whole lot of software that you download, all you've got to do is you've got to only unzip the first 3 DVDs, which belongs to the rapid install software, and all the others will be unzipped by that software. In fact, it doesn't belong to rapid install software, it belongs to staging area CD, that's what it calls it. It helps you to unzip rest of the software automatically. So you don't have to actually unzip the software manually. You have to first unzip the first 3 DVDs and then run a couple of commands to automatically build the stage area via the utility provided by Oracle. Basically, that utility is nothing but a Unix shell script. It is called as build stage.sh. Again, The exact process of staging area I'm going to show you a little while later. Then we'll move on, and once a staging area has been created, we will actually go and verify the staging area, and we'll check the output and log files to make sure if everything is correct, the staging area has been made correctly by this utility. Okay, now staging area is complete, so one major task has been complete. Since it's a new process of creating the staging area via a script, a lot of people struggle there. In fact, when I started the installation, I also got a while to get my head around that, but that's where I will explain you very clearly and easily that how to go about setting up the staging area and verifying it to make sure everything is correct. Because unless your staging area is correct, you can't go with the next step of installation. Some software file is missing, your installation will stall, and you wouldn't be able to go further at all. Fine, so that's an extremely important step, and if you have done that successfully, be assured that your ref of the installation would be not that problematic. Then we will go to the next step of actually installing or creating the Unix users. So what you can do it is, you can basically install the complete Oracle EPS 12.2.2 using one user, or you can separate it out into two users, one user for database tier and one user for application tier. The first one is called as Express Installation, which is faster and especially good for novice users who are not very familiar with the server. Whereas the second kind of installation, which is called as a standard installation, is a standard practice, and this is what is used in company or corporate environments for maintaining their Oracle application servers. So that's what we will actually do it is, we'll go about using the standard installation and create two users for database tier and application tiers. Then we'll create a folder for Oracle inventory file, and we will make some settings. This file is extremely important. It's just one file, but it can make or break your entire installation, because if that file is not found, your installation will not proceed. So this is just two to three small steps, but you must do it. I'm going to tell you how to go about it. So once you have done your pre-installation steps, so these are basically the pre-installation step. The next step is, we will actually go and start the hands-on installation. So what is involved in hands-on installation? It's just going and navigating to the staging area and starting the rapid install wizard. And once the rapid install wizard is started, it'll ask you for a couple of settings in terms of inputs for providing for database tiers and application tier. Plus, you can optionally set or change the default ports that Oracle defaults automatically. We will do all that, and then we will proceed ahead as a next step of validating the configurations that we have given, and if everything is okay, we will start the installation process. And to be perfectly honest, I did not face any problems here at all, and the last screen that is shown, which gives complete validation information, was all green tick marks. So I didn't have to go back and fix something and restart the installation. First time itself, I could manage to go through. And that's where I will tell you how to go about doing that. Once the installation is started, then it takes a couple of hours for completing the installation, which again depends on your server configuration or the machine on which you're installing EBS. For instance, we have used a good server, so installation was pretty fast. But if you're using your laptop or a desktop, then be prepared to give anywhere between 12 to 15 hours or until even 24 hours if you are using that. If you are using a USB stick for your installation, I don't know if you can find such a big USB, but if you are indeed using it, then be prepared to give even more time, because it's an external storage device. It takes more time for input output from your computer to that external device. Anyway, so that's the actual installation side. And once that is over, then you've got to do a number of post-installation steps. So in terms of post-installation, the first thing that you've got to do it is find your run and patch file system in your application that you have installed, okay, in your application environment. This is important because this is this run and patch are like clones of each other, and it helps you to basically apply the patches even while the users are browsing. You don't have to bring the system down, and those patches can be applied using ADOP or ADOP utility. And that's where you first apply it in the patch environment, and then you kind of in the background you clone it onto the run environment. So it's very important that you got to find out your environment details, and that's where we'll run a script to find out those details. Then the next step is, if it's a production environment, then you must change the default passwords. So we'll understand how to go about changing those default passwords. But if it's a vision instance, don't worry about it. You can leave the vision instance as it is with the default passwords. Then we will have to understand the mandatory database patches that you have got to apply. And what we will do it is, we will apply it using the ADOP utility. So that's where you will come hands-on in terms of using the ADOP utility. Plus, in addition to database tier patches, there are a number of mandatory application tier patches that you must apply in post-installation environment. Again, we will use ADOP, so you will have more practice on ADOP. Then we will move on and run utld check utility to compile and check basically database objects. And since it compiles and checks all the database objects, be prepared for a long time. In my case, it took around 3 hours time to have that done, but I had a considerably faster machine. But you have got a slower machine, then be prepared to wait for a little longer. Once you have done that, the next step is setting up the database tier environment. This is like, you know, if you are an experienced DBA, or if you are an experienced Linux or application guy, then you can easily do it. There is no big deal in that, and I will tell you how to go about doing it. So you've got to set up the database environment in terms of, you know, writing the scripts and starting the listener and then starting the database. So that's where I will go into the server, and I will show you on hands-on how to go about doing that. Once you have started the database and listener using the OraVis or Oracle user which you have made for Oracle environment, then you will switch the user and log in as application user to start the application services. So all the application services reside in application tier environment. So you will actually log in and then run those scripts to start the application tier environment. Now remember that as a part of starting the application tier environment, what you used to do until release 12.1.3, there is one addition there, and that's what you call it as WebLogic server. So this time you've also got to start the WebLogic server as a part of starting the application tier environment. Oracle has provided Unix shell files which you can use to start all the application tier services, and it has got inbuilt script to start the node manager and the WebLogic admin server apart from starting the other services. So you don't have to worry really much, but I will also tell you separately how to go about starting the WebLogic node manager and the WebLogic admin server, and how to go about stopping the WebLogic admin server. We will also quickly discuss how to go about bouncing in Apache. For instance, you know, in real production environment, sometimes if a form change is made and then your developer comes back to you to ask you to bounce the Apache. So bouncing Apache, kind of making sure that the changes reflects in the front end. So that's where we've got to understand the concept of bouncing Apache. Then we'll move on and understand the concept of installing the GRE and linking it in the browser. So your server part is done. Now it's time to go on to the client side. And obviously the whole idea for installing server is access the applications. So it's time to have Oracle GRE installed on the front end, and then configure the client settings such that you can access it via a browser. So that's what we will configure it, and then we will launch Oracle eBusiness Suite in the browser, just as I have done it a little while ago to show you that we have installed release 12.2.2. And once we have done that, then optionally we'll go and backup Oracle applications. So that at this stage, it kind of completes the release 12.2.0 installation, and we have also verified it by launching the browser. So you can also do other verification checks, but if you are satisfied, then we'll go to the next step of actually upgrading from release 12.2.0 to release 12.2.2. So let's understand what goes into the upgrade of release 12.2.2. Now, before I go into the upgrade aspects, I will also like to add that the complete installation steps that we have taken and what I've explained you as an overview so far has also been documented on our website. So let me just take you through there, just in case if you're interested in exploring. So let me just minimize this, and I will go to a browser, and I will simply go to our website, which is www.aclnz.com, and here you simply go to the rightmost side menu, which is called as resources. Click on that. And here, scroll down a bit, and then you will see something called as blocks. So click on this one. And then you will scroll down to see the blog starting with installation steps. So let's first find it out. That's the one, release 12.2.2 installation from scratch. So if you open that, it contains the summary of all the steps that we have taken, plus it also gives you the installation details, what I was trying to explain you a little while ago. Now, in terms of the software download requirement, it also shows that. So if you scroll down a little bit, it shows you appendices. So this appendix B shows you all the mandatory software that you got to have for successfully installing release 12.2.0. So if you click on this one, so these are the software that you've got to download from edelivery.oracle.com, and this is all you need to install release 12.2.0. You don't have to download anything more than this, apart from the download for patches that we will apply before and after the installation. That's first thing. And then all the patches that have been applied as a part of this installation of release 12.2.0 has also been listed over here. So that has been listed in Appendix A. So if you click on reference documents and list of mandatory patches, it'll open another window, and it's gonna list all the patches that we have applied as a part of this installation. Plus it'll also give you a reference to a number of good documents that we have referred. For instance, eBusiness Suite installation guide, it gives a complete link. Then it also gives a number of articles on Oracle, My Oracle Support website, that provides more detail about the eBusiness Suite installation, plus the number of patches to apply. And these are the kind of patches that we have applied before and after release 12.2.0 installation. So you should have this reference, and this is pretty handy. You can go and refer to that. And as you would see, I have given you all the information that I have over here, so it will be kind of handy for you, and you don't have to struggle. Okay, having said that, now let's go back to our presentation and let's understand what has to be done in terms of upgrading to release 12.2.2. So in terms of upgrading, what you've got to do it is you've got to first apply a mega patch. Okay, this is again a summary. Apart from applying a mega patch, there are a couple of more patches which goes into it, but what I have shown you here are the major steps. So you've got to apply a mega patch, which is called as release 12.2.2 AD and TXK release update pack. And that we will apply using the latest utility which has come into release 12.2.0 environment, which is called as ADOP patching utility. So we'll apply, and we'll first start by opening a new phase for applying the patches. So the prepare phase itself will take around half hour to 45 minutes to prepare the environment when you run it for the first time. And then you've got to run these steps one by one to finally apply the patches, then cut over and clean so that the complete patch cycle completes. Once you have done, so these were kind of preliminary tasks. So this is the mega patch, and apart from that, if you go on to the blog which I've just shown you, you've got to apply all these patches which I have listed over here apart from the mega patch I've shown you. So these are the database tire patches you've got to apply, and this is an application tire patch you have got to apply before you actually go about applying the release 12.2.2 AD and TXK release update pack. And again, as a part of this patch, you've got to apply 3 patches in total. Okay, and then only you're ready for applying the release wide patch for upgrading to release 12.2.2. So let's go back and understand the next step. So once you have done this, then you go about applying the release 12.2.2 suite wide release update pack. So there is one mega patch, okay, which is like 5 or 6 DVDs to be precise, and then there is a smaller patch which contains the help files for those upgrade to 12.2.2. So the details of all that has again been listed over here. So this is the mega patch, and this is the smaller patch for online help. Okay, now let's go back. So what's next? So once you have done that, you kind of completed your upgrade. But even before you go and start testing your environment from the front end, you've got to make sure you synchronize your run and patch file systems. Okay, so currently you have been applying these patches in one of the environment, but you've got to synchronize those files to make sure both are at the same level and there is no differentiation. So that's where you've got to run a couple of commands to synchronize the file system, and then you can optionally run a patch wizard, which you have to run it from front end application environment so that it downloads the mandatory or optional high priority patches recommended by Oracle as a part of your as a part of your day-to-day maintenance, or what you call as business as usual or BAU. So at this point of time, even though you don't do this, you can complete over here. So once you have done this part, then you don't have to worry in terms of starting the database and application tire environment, because all these patches have been applied as hot patches, or in other words, using ADOP ADOP utility, which uses the database and application tire while they are run in the background, it applies. Okay, so as soon as you are complete, you don't have to restart them. You are actually basically ready to go and test your front end. So you simply go to front end and test, just as what I've done a little while ago in the browser over here. So you simply go to the front end, type the user and password and log in. But in terms of the actual front end, this is pretty much same as what you had in release 12.1.3+. Okay, so if you are familiar with release 12.1.3, then I don't see any difference in terms of look and feel of the environment, apart from a whole lot of functional changes that have come in the background, plus in the technical application environment with the addition of ADOP utility and WebLogic server environment. So that is, I would say, pretty much all in terms of upgrading from release 12.2.0 to release 12.2.2 in terms of overview. Now let's get started with the actual course and understand right from the installation of VirtualBox, then installing the virtual machine, then installing the Linux on that virtual machine, and then carrying on further until this stage. And to be perfectly honest, I'm quite excited about sharing my knowledge with you, because I have done a bit of a homework in terms of bringing all these steps together. And in fact, I have also written a installation guide for my reference, which I call it as MD120 or installation routine document. And it has been a pretty good experience having that installed release 12.2.2 and having first hands-on experience on using ADOP utility plus using the WebLogic admin server environment.